All right, we're going to start at 6 o'clock. First up at bat will be our own Lynn Sibley. Tell us which areas you're going to review, Lynn. I know it's the same thing every year, but just so we have all the paperwork ready.
Should we approve the minutes first?
You guys always want to do the minutes.
Make a motion, we approve the minutes.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
I don't know, I guess I'll start with town clerk. Actually, my budget's gone down a little bit because it's not an election year next year, so I dropped that a little bit. Some of my expenses have risen though, like there's more mailings due to this new automatic registration. Almost everyone who goes to the registry and does something now gets registered to vote, even though they might already be registered to vote. And every time that happens, I have to send a mailing, so it's a little redundant, but other than that, you know, the town clerk budget is pretty much the same.
Same at the town clerk budget, the request is $39,983. Comments or questions for Lynn concerning town clerk budget? All right, next.
The treasurer collector budget. Again, that went down a little bit. There's really no drastic changes here. Everything's pretty much the same. Unless you have questions about it.
Looks pretty straightforward.
Okay. And let's see. Emergency management is also the same as last year. It's a pretty slim budget anyways. I think it's $950, so it's not huge. And that's remained the same. And then you get into the more drastic ones, like tax taking. Again, I'm asking for $10,000. I'm getting things cleaned up. I've actually, this week, finished off cleaning up one of my tax takings for $20,000. Another one got paid off for $28,000. And then I had another one that was $19,000. And what happens with that, basically, it all goes into free cash. So, getting
what
there.
What does the $10,000 cover during
the legal
process?
Fees. I have to charge legal fees to something. But then I also charge the person in tax taking those same fees. So they have to pay those fees off, but it doesn't go back into the tax taking account. It just goes into general miscellaneous revenue. So in a way, that $10,000 does get repaid in the future.
Sure.
Through the tax takings.
Yeah.
So my next, I took care of all the bigger tax takings. The larger properties, the larger value ones. Now we're getting down into the smaller ones, so it won't be quite as impressive, but I just keep plugging away at those.
So how much have we been able to recoup?
About 60,000 this year so far.
$10,000 is pretty well spent.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's great.
Now that's different than the ones we don't know, property owners.
The owner unknowns I haven't tackled yet, just because they require so much research and the legal fees on those is going to be even more, unless they're land of low value. If they're land of low value, then we'll move them into the assessor's area and they would be able to tackle those.
What's that threshold?
Changes every year. I think it's a value of $23,000. So, or 23 or 24,000. So that's my tax taking. Are there any questions, further questions on that? Temporary loan interest, I rarely spend, but I just, we haven't had to borrow in a very long time. So if you want to delete anything, you can start with $1,000 on the temporary loan interest. But it is there as a buffer. You know, occasionally we have some borrowing that we, a special project or something, and we may end up short on the interest part, so we can use this account. Haven't done that in a few years, though. The OPEB, I don't know what your plans are on that. You've been doing $25,000 a year. Right now we have, $162,758 in the OPEB account. The unfunded liability that remains, so that's minus that $162,000, is still $1,096,000.
How does that look?
I mean, I think we're doing more than many other towns are, that we're actually putting something aside into OPEB. They haven't mandated that you have to. You do have to claim it on your in the accountant's side of the books, but it's not a requirement that you fund it yet. But the fact that we've started is a good thing. So, and I do. We just got the new actuarial on the OPEB account, so that figure I gave you, that 1,096,000, is the new actuarial figure. Life insurance is the same. The group health insurance, I'm actually keeping the same as last year. The rates did not increase, which is good news.
Yep.
Harper's payroll is increasing a little bit because of the costs of the W-2s. Those have gone up per W-2. So I raised it $150. And long-term debt is the only thing we have there is the manganese system. And that gets paid out of the enterprise fund, correct? The manganese
is paid out. This is the last payment on the
The water meters are
fire
in
truck, right?
Oh, the fire truck, yes. The water meters are being paid, the last ones this year.
Yeah.
And the fire truck is in 2021.
So
that one will be gone for next year, for the year after that. And I think that's all of my budgets.
You really don't have any significant increases about saying.
Yeah.
Any general comments or questions?
Just one question, Lynn. What's driving the workers' comp increase?
That's not my area. That's
for
Sorry.
I thought that was your.
So we had this is an estimate that I hope to refine before we finalize the budget. But we had one significant workers' comp claim. And we had a small
so
one.
So it carries over?
I expect that. Well, so this is an insurance. So we insure against workers' comp. So I suspect there'll be a premium increase.
Reaction.
Yeah, I'm just not sure what it will be. But I hope to have a better number before we finalize the budget.
All righty, Lynn, thank you. We appreciate everything you do. And thanks.
Okay, thank you.
Next up, we're going to ask guests from Franklin Regional Technical School to make a presentation. They've got the longest to drive and the longest drive home, so.
Do you want a PowerPoint, or what do you want to do?
We have our own screen and PowerPoint all set to go.
You want
to? Okay. Take us along. Yeah,
are you okay with that one, or I can set up our little screen here, depending on what you guys want.
What's easier?
Yeah, what's easier for you?
I'll set up the little screen.
It will take me 2 minutes, and I'll be all set up and ready to go, so I apologize for that. I'm sorry we were about 3-4 minutes late.
We were presenting at Town Hall, and no one was there.
He used to live in Whately
for a couple of years, and I didn't know this place existed.
He used to live in Whately, and he got me lost, so I'm gonna blame it on him.
It happens.
Russ, you got about 45 seconds left, and we should be set up.
You're gonna point it this way, right, Rick?
Yeah. Don't mess up on me now, come on. Pressure.
So you're gonna bring a student in to do it.
You know, we're gonna screen.
They'd be doing a hell of a lot quicker, wouldn't they?
They would've been done by now.
It always makes us feel good when we see the students doing good stuff.
That's right.
I usually just hand them my phone and say, how do I do this?
We've got a screen here on the wall, right?
Yeah, we can tell if it was easy.
Step down on this presentation.
Oh, here. Yeah, thank you.
Mr. Hart. Yeah, he just said, okay.
Hey, go plug that in. I'll get it.
Okay.
Can we hope?
Anyone need an extra copy of the budget book? Do you want?
Here's the.
They have color.
There's a black and white one.
I got two or three extras.
I'm good.
Let's say if you need to move it back, so it's like you want. I think that should do it. Maybe move it back a couple.
A little bit.
No, I mean forward, I'm sorry. They can move it forward. It should pop up to this. Move it back to some inch. I think you got it. I think you're doing better.
It's like being home with my wife. Move the couch a couple inches up.
It's kind of crooked, but we'll make it work.
Say, before we get started, could you introduce yourself and?
Yes, I'm Rick Martin. I'm the superintendent for Rensselaer County Technical School. Russ Kobus is our business manager. He's been there for about 25 years. I've been to school for 12. So we've had some longevity here at the school district. I don't know how to fix that warp screen, but we'll get the idea of what we're talking about, like the old Batman and Robin shows. What we do, we do appreciate you guys having us here. We do send out a letter every fall to all of the finance committees for all 19 member towns, inviting ourselves to present our budget prior to a town vote. And we do appreciate you responding to us and allowing us to present. What we like to do is we go through. This is probably our 11th or 12th one that we've done so far this season. And what we like to do is kind of show you and try to get you up to speed is how we're spending the money so far. And then we're gonna show you our total enrollment. Then we're gonna break down how it fits with Whately's enrollment, what's our projection for the following year so you could budget a year out, and what it looks like moving forward in the future. So if you allow us about 10-15 minutes, if that would be okay, to get you guys up to speed of what we're doing.
Go.
All right. And the first one is, this is kind of what we show at a lot of our events. It's a quick 30-second clip, gives you an update of what we're doing with the data set. Some of the things that we have added over the last year is advanced placement courses. We're getting a little bit more of that. We have a new veterinary science program. So some of the animals that you saw in that film are brand new to us. Just this fall, we started that. We'll talk a little bit more about that. We have a new co-op coordinator position. We do build a new home every year, and we'll talk about that. We revamped our welding program, our electrical shop. We're starting another new shop and medical assistant in LPN. We refurbish our cafeteria and continue with various initiatives. This is the additional staff that is in our budget. We have four new special education positions due to an increased number in special education students, which we will show you by a graph later on in the slide. We have two new veterinary instructors, a new electrical instructor. We reallocated a carpentry instructor. We added a half-time history and English instructor and a 1.0 culinary arts. We continue to share a music instructor with our Irving School District, who comes in the morning and then we have in the afternoon. And we share our Spanish instructor initially with GCC, and we added a health course half-time. This is our school getting recognized. We're the only vocational school in the state to get recognized for advanced placement. And the type of progress we have had over the last 6 years. And we are one of 18 school districts in the statewide to receive this recognition from the National AP Center.
Is there a question on that?
Yep.
What course, like, is your AP courses like college credit?
Yes. We do it for the English composition, we do it for the computer science and AP stats.
Okay, thank you.
Yep. So we started in this fall. This has been years of an initiative. As you probably have found out over the years, I went to this town meeting probably 5 years ago. You might have had a few students that gone out to Smith for like $45,000 a year. So we decided to make sure that we're starting a program that students can gravitate to instead of our little towns paying those extra expenses. So we started this little veterinary science program as a goat. I won't take it through the instruction module, which is 10 seconds, but we have all our freshmen learning from our veterinarian about a blood sample. They have their new garments on. They're excited. We just do one grade level at a time, freshmen this year, then sophomores, then juniors and seniors, until the program is full. In order to accompany that many, we are going to be building a veterinary science center to accompany the 80 additional students that our building is going to be bringing in. And in year one, it's already filled up. In year two, we have right now have a total of 220 applicants, in which half of those are females for the first time. So we're real excited about that. Generally, we have 70% males. So we're real excited about that. And we turned a science classroom into a veterinary clinic within the building envelope to save costs with a $275,000 competitive grant. So we were able to get a grant that paid for all the state-of-the-art equipment, the entire facility, no money from the operating budget. Yes?
Who heads up this veterinary clinic? Who is...
We hired a veterinarian.
Oh, you did.
We hired a veterinarian, and we have articulation agreements that are being developed with Tufts University and the new UMass Veterinarian Center that started up in Mount Wachusett for veterinary technicians, and we have industry partners and local vets all part of our program advisory board. So we have industry partners, we have colleges. Mm-hmm. It's a really popular program based on the applicants we got moving forward. This is just some of the things with the animals. They come on Fridays, and we have a fish hatchery. And one thing about the animals that I should note is that when the students are taking urinalysis samples, having these students dressed up in their blue veterinary garments and run around that little yard trying to get a urine sample should be on YouTube, and we'll get a million hits. So we have the fishery hatchery. We have a veterinary clinic lab, again, all bought with grant money, this entire facility, every last penny of it. We have a grooming area.
Offer that grooming to the community?
Not yet. We're going to wait till the students developing enough credit hours and competencies before we consider what we're going to be doing. Well, one thing we do not want to do is compete with local vets. Yeah. And so we want to make sure that we utilize it for skill building and education and not competition. That's extremely important to us. We have an ultrasound machine, state-of-the-art. We have microscope, get all kinds of really good equipment. Today's ultrasound machines on this could do what an x-ray machine could do 5 years ago. And then we're going to be starting up with another grant, $250,000. We just got released on February 25th. We are starting up for next fall a simulation lab for certified medical assistants in an LPN program. And so it's long overdue. It will be part of our health technology program, and we're real excited about that opportunity. Over the last year before that, we were able to get another competitive grant for $500,000, and this time we revamped our entire welding shop. We had new CNC benders and cutters and ventilation systems, not to mention a state-of-the-art robotic arm that you see here. So the students get to learn how to run, set up, and program complex CNC machinery, which is a job skill. Now our students have the employability skills to go out and get these higher paid jobs. So we're real excited about that. That we had a ribbon cutting ceremony. We improved the square footage of the space, all internally without going to the external part of the building. And again, every last dime of it was paid through the grant. This is a new house that the kids built. We established just about 3 years ago a foundation agreement to begin a 501(c) with the Greenfield Savings Bank, and a foundation was established that they pay for the property, the materials, and all of the supplies, and they pay for the foundation. Our kids come in and build the house, the landscape, and do everything else. They turn around and sell that house with a large profit, right? They take that profit and they buy the next lot, materials, and the excavation, and they build the foundation, and then we come in and build that house. We're finishing up our second house, and we just bought a third piece of property. So every year or so, it's going to continue on. What a nice hands-on experience. And now that we're doing this, our construction trade numbers are going way up, because a lot of the kids and parents want these kids to have real life experience. So this is just some renovations we did with some bond authorization when we had to repave everything. What should be noted is that we did 36 parking lot lights. Our students did all the light heads. They dug all the trenches. They laid all the conduit, which allowed us to save a lot of money and add some light for our football field as well. Some of the freshman training that has gone on is you got to learn how to build the little houses before the big ones. And then they learn how to do some of the walkways as well. We refurbished our cafeteria completely with excess funds from a cafeteria director that was able to get us into the black by over $100,000 in 4 years. So we refurbished the entire cafeteria. We had to add another floor to the electrical shop to accommodate all the students. And just to show you, artwork is done in very many forms. This is a really fancy guitar that is run by, this is coil wire for the welding. These are spark plugs. If you look closely, this is a chain that goes around the whole exterior of, this is sitting in an art show right now. It's an amazing, I just wanted to show you there's different ways to do art. And we're really proud of this girl that was able to go in the welding shop and find all this stuff lying around, and she came out with that. And so we do a Skills USA competition, which is national and local. Our kids get recognized in each of our shop areas, and they compete against others from across the state and across the country. And there's some community events. We like to service our kids in the community. We had about 400 or 500 kids at these events, and we do an annual car show. So now let's get to the numbers. Well, let's get to the numbers.
So that's it?
I was trying to go real fast. I don't want to, because I could take a lot more time, and I can answer any questions you have at the end. The numbers here, Franklin County's enrollment trend, as you can see, this year we're 485 in district. We're projecting that number to be 518 next year, and we can confidently say that based on the number that we have graduating and the number we'll have coming in. You know, and then the next year is even going to be bigger because we have a small graduating class, and we are trending with a solid incoming enrollment based on all the new offerings that you just were exposed to. So we will be in the mid 500s very shortly. Out of the special education population, remember we said that slide with all the new additions? Look where we are with special education percentile compared to everybody else in the county. All the other regional school districts, Greenfield, Pioneer, Frontier, Maha, Mohawk, and Turnus, and we are double on average. Percentage of students coming in.
So not percentage of your budget, it's percentage of students.
It's percentage of students, which we're obligated by law to provide services for those, so we naturally had to add those positions. So the largest increase in our budget is in the instructional area, which is what we, I just wanted to show you how we score up against everybody else. Whately's enrollment. We're at this number now. We've been in a series of nines for a while. We up three students. We are projecting that number. We have, right now, we have one graduate and two applications. So that probably, right now, I'm projecting about 13. Usually in the smaller towns like Whately, that number will go up or down because some kids may not decide to come that applied, or we may get an extra application or two before it's done. But this is just to project out. The number's not going down next year. So we're either going to be at that number, one or two above or one or two below. So just to kind of give you an idea moving forward for the following budget cycle, we can accurately say that. And we're usually pretty close when we go out to the FinCom meetings and project the previous year. So that's a pretty good guess on what we would expect right now. Russ?
So now that Rick did all the sexy parts, we'll get into the numbers here a little bit. As you know, through education reform that happened many years ago, the state dictates a minimum contribution formula for all of our towns. We have 19 member towns in our school district, and unfortunately, you and Whately are considered one of our richer towns. So the minimum contribution that gets spit out by the state formula is up there on the screen in one of the million middle columns. And as you can see, since our student population is growing, if you look at the far right column, the average cost per pupil is dropping as we're adding students in and not having to add a tremendous amount of costs at this point. Now, I know we showed you a lot of stuff, we're hitting you with a lot of stuff tonight, but actually there's some efficiencies we're achieving because we're growing the school back to a population that it was meant to be way back in the day. So your enrollment's gonna grow from 9 to 12 students. Our overall enrollment for Franklin County Tech grew by 4.7% this year. Our average assessment to our member towns grew by 3%. The extra monies that we needed for the growth that Rick showed you on the screens prior come to us in the form of Chapter 70 money. We are both a school in growth mode and not in a hold harmless, if some of you understand the education formula. Many of the schools in Franklin County, their populations have dropped significantly over the years and fallen off the cliff. And it's gonna take those schools many years to get back up on top of the cliff. We're lucky enough that our population never dropped too drastically, so that now we're getting additional Chapter 78 for each student coming in, plus the tweak in the formula. So we're getting two hits. We also, so in the budget book has all kinds of detail, more detail than you probably ever wanted to know, but we're gonna highlight a few things. We also are asking for, this is our second year of asking for our member towns for a capital assessment. Some of you may remember two or three years ago, we went out to all 19 towns, had a ballot vote on the same day, got permission to borrow money, and now we have capital assessments going to our towns. The capital assessment is not going to be the same dollar amount each year like our home mortgages is. The expected life of parts of our project are different. So the parking lots had a useful life of X number of years. The roof had a useful life of X number of years. So that number is going to fluctuate. But
we have new windows and doors as well.
Windows and doors, yeah, is the third project that we did with the borrowing.
Right.
The $7,300 that we charged you last year's capital assessment and this year's $6,200, your capital assessment for the remaining 13 years of this loan is going to be somewhere in between those. It won't stray too far from there. So that'll give you a rough guess of what to plug into your budget, or Brian to plug into the budget, or whoever's doing the capital piece
for future years will be in that dollar range. The, again, all the details in the budget book, but just to highlight where our increases came in our, both our sources of funding and our uses of funding. Our major increases, like I said just a couple minutes ago, was in Chapter 78. So we are doing well. We got an extra $250,000 or so in Chapter 78 this year. We also saw a bump in Chapter 78 last year due to the formula tweak. And because our enrollment, we expect our enrollment to grow, we expect to continue to see Chapter 78 in a favorable position for us for the next several years to come. And that's, again, based on the tweak in the formula that the state did, plus our increased enrollment. Major increases in our uses of funding. As Rick showed you on the screen earlier, we have added quite a few employees. The only brand new program we've added is the veterinary science program. We are revamping the health technology program, so that's where Rick was talking about getting a grant to do some stuff in health tech. We have revamped a bunch of shops, but as our shop capacity reaches its maximum, we have to flip to the academic side of the house, and now we've got to start to grow some of the academic spaces, because as the students start coming in the building, we're limited with space in the building for academics. So we'll be, most of the money that were extra funds in this year's budget are reinvested into salaries, like Rick had said earlier. We are also moving a chunk of money from our E&D surplus. So towns, you guys have something called free cash. Schools, we have something called E&D. We are moving $300,000 from our E&D surplus into a capital stabilization fund. So 5, 6, 7 years ago, all of you member towns gave us permission to start a capital stabilization fund for the school, and we're investing some money in that.
And the reason for that is that we realize how small a majority of our towns are, and we already went out to bond for the new windows and paving and roof. We'll be in a position, we were talking about, well, if we don't do something in our budget, we're going to be going out to bond again for the new veterinary center at an even higher cost than we currently went out to bond for. So rather than do that, we're going to play the long game. And we are going to refine our budget, make sure that we can move money from our excess and deficiency into capital stabilization and pay for the new facility through that channel over the next couple of years. A great place to eat, by the way. If you haven't been there, hot dogs are wonderful. It's a great place to go.
Yeah.
Huh?
Did you go there?
No, we did not. But I certainly enjoy eating there.
A lot of town meetings held right there.
Yeah. So any questions?
How about the labs? Where do the animals come from?
So we utilize, right now we have a couple of sheep that the veterinarian owns and she brings in. And a couple of goat. As far as the massive amount of animals, we utilize Animal Adventures. That's a company where a former graduate owns that company with their father, and they bring the animals every Friday.
So the animals aren't on site.
Correct.
Say, out of curiosity, who's your grant writer?
Me.
Good for you.
I'm chasing another one right now. I'm busy writing that one.
When it comes to you track administrative costs, I know you have a line there.
Yeah.
I don't know how you define them. I mean, when you go through a budget like this, there are admin spots all over the place as well as cost. And you're a little over $700,000 in total admin. You know, when I do the admin, just I'm not in your place, but I'm over a mil. So. But again, it depends how you define it. Right. But do you track it? I mean, you obviously track it year to year, and do you ever have a discussion with the school board as to how you define it?
Yes, that's a great question. Several years back, when our enrollments were on the decline, we reduced our admin. That's the first place we usually go in order to have some more efficiencies within the budget. We had a curriculum director and a vocational director, one for the academic and one for the voc. Well, we cut back on one of those. And then You know, we were able to have a new assistant principal come in. We're at the point now, we haven't grown that back, yet our numbers are now bigger than they were back then, so we're in a situation. We might be adding back, depending on what the profile of the students coming through the door are, to help with the dean of students or something on that idea. That administrative cost is also encompassed in his office. He has a couple of people that help with the HR component, as well as the finances. So we have our building principal, we have our special education director, and some schools at a vocational level have a special education director and a guidance director. We have one person doing both of those jobs for efficiency sake, and I think if he were here tonight, he wouldn't say he's being too efficient, because he's doing a couple of different jobs. So we're trying to keep an eye on that so that doesn't get out of control.
You cut out special education expense and follow it, or is it just woven into?
The special education expenses are in our budget line item as special education instructors, and then we have others, one that cut into some of our entitlement grants in Title I, Title II, Title IIA, Title III, and Title IV. So we utilize that as well. So it's because the special education cost is pretty substantial when we're looking at our per pupil cost. And if you're an out-of-district student, you're paying, $3,000+ on top of that.
So how do your per pupil costs compare to other vocational schools in the state?
Where our average is $13,320.
Right.
And say, for instance, the town of Whately is, $18,500?
Yep.
So the state has decided in their wisdom of developing this formula that has relative wealth and property value and all that stuff, that you're just as rich as Wellesley, Wayland, Weston, Dover, and Sherbin, Needham, Newton. I don't believe that.
But we don't have the Starbucks that they have.
Yeah. So the formula is not a fair formula. Have they ever been out here and seen these towns? This is not, and so it's per pupil cost is a very relative figure that is dictated to us from the state. So we're at $13,320. Some of the more affluent areas of the other VOC schools, like Minuteman, which has 450 students, but they're at $18,875. So they all vary depending on the town that surround them. And so ours is artificially higher than it should be based on the relative wealth, but that's the formula that is developed and dictated to us.
Is that based on zip codes?
I'm not exactly sure. It is based on relative.
Because we have four zip codes for this town, and other towns have similar issues with.
Yeah. Correct.
Which one of them do you include for this?
So some of our member towns are Buckland, Shelburne area, correct?
Well,
they call it Shelburne Falls because it's part Buckland. The zip codes could be screwing up your state formula.
Yeah.
That's beyond what we know, but that would be something that you might want to inquire with state.
Have we looked at that, Brian?
Yeah.
Or do we get information on that every year, what that is?
I'm not sure if they break down, how they break down those.
It's a great question.
Because I've heard surrounding towns have an issue with that, not the Buckland Shelburne, but towns by themselves, like Deerfield, have a concern of how that is developed by the state and what zip codes you put in there. And we have four zip codes. I don't know which ones you're using there. If you use center of town, that's maybe more than the ones that have others.
But we don't actually know that they use zip codes, Fred. You're supposed
to. No, we do know. Buckland has
a. No, I know. We don't know that the state formula uses zip codes to determine things. You're supposing that, and I feel like we're going off on a big tangent
over something that
we don't actually even know if it's true.
I've heard from other towns that they look at their zip codes.
So that's something that we can look into further. Relative to the formula, I know of no one who understands the formula.
Right.
The last person I knew who had a handle on it was Paul Newland, and that was about 10 years ago. And since then, it's kind of fallen to the wayside. So that's something maybe we need to get a little sharper on.
Yeah.
Any questions?
So what programs, say, does Smith have that you don't have?
Right now, we don't have large agricultural type of programs yet, but that's something in the future we will be taking a look at. So they don't have veterinary science either.
Okay.
You know, but when you're 14 years old and you're looking and you love animals, well, we have that now, we have that option. You may not know what avenue you want to go into, but having veterinary science is a career path that allows kids to go on to college if they so choose. We'll have college credits that the kids will be able to obtain. If they don't want to go that avenue, we also have the dog grooming area as well. So we have a couple of components into that that will draw these kids to have that type of interest. But usually the little kids, once they see those animals, that's it.
Criminal justice is another area that Smith has. We don't have, and I think there was one other one. Wasn't there three that they have that we don't? Maybe just those two.
No, there were those two. They identified, I think, three, but we actually have the other one, which is horticulture.
Yep.
Because you have an outgoing placement in the budget, right? For a charter, outgoing,
or school.
School
choice, yeah. That's usually someone who's on the border, such as for Monty Tech,
right.
that student may live in Orange. And they wanted to do diesel mechanics. Well, we don't have diesel mechanics, but Monty Tech does. So they'll go to Monty Tech, and we'll get stuck with the school choice cash for that. But that's accurate.
Yeah, Monty Tech is the only school near us that actually accepts choice students. So the other Volk schools around us, they will accept students on full tuition, but they have to be programs that we don't. We don't offer at our school. So what we usually tell towns is it's worth your while to follow up later in students' freshman year, if you've got students going to Smith, to make sure that they are staying in that program that Franklin Tech doesn't offer. Because technically, we do a thing called Freshman Exploratory, and they get to try four or five different programs. If they went down there for the agricultural program that we don't offer, but ended up in welding, which we do offer, you have every right to tell that student to go to Franklin County Tech and save yourself the money from Smith Volk. So it's worth a follow-up from our member towns to call those schools and say, hey, just want to know where, you know, Johnny so-and-so is.
Some towns that have done that have been surprised, because there have been kids that have been located in machine technology, for example, that went there for agriculture.
Right. Well, good to know.
Where are you project increases of some 100 students in the next couple of years. I'm just curious, where is that coming from? Where are you drawing it?
A couple of things, all right? The last 2 years we have had enrollments of 143 and 153. Prior to that was 138. We used to average about 125, all right? So now that average is really kicking up a lot. We have a graduating class of 115 this year. We have 220 plus applicants, which will probably grow to closer to 250, right? We're gonna bring in 160 students. So 115 to 160, you got 35 right there, right? The following year, we graduate 103. If we bring in another 140, 150, there's the increase right there. Now, not all of those will be in district, but the majority of those will be. So our enrollment's definitely going to increase. It's not a matter of a wild guess. It's definitely going to happen. We know it's happening.
Right, so where are these students coming from? They're coming from high schools, regional schools?
They're coming from the other...
Or is population increasing and your percent of population is...
Well, our population over a 10-year trend has been pretty flat.
No, I'm not population of the school, population of the area.
Right. I'm talking about school-aged children. We did a 10-year trend analysis.
Okay.
And we look at that 10-year trend, and it looks like it's going to be pretty flat for the next 10 years. There are some higher numbers in those younger grade levels that weren't there a few years ago. So we don't know how that's going to project out. But right now, we can confidently say that we'll probably go up a little bit, and then we'll dip back down to that mid-500 range.
Well, it seems to me like you're offering a product that's attractive. And when kids see it, more kids gravitate towards it.
So you're going to pull more out of the population than you were in the past, just by what we see.
And that's what's happening.
All right, well, thank you very much for coming in.
How much more will the veterinary program and the LPN program expand the budget? Are you going to absorb it?
Well, what happens when we build something, they will come, so we draw more students, which actually pay for the instruction. All the equipment is coming out of the grant, off the operating budget. So it's going to be very exciting.
So about the million or so dollars of grants that Rick showed you were all equipment-based grants. So the only real growth is going to be the two, the veterinarian, and we want the vet tech as an instructor too. So there'll be two instructors that'll grow through the new program.
So it's not going to go exponentially like this.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, this should be a revenue plus for us easily.
What's your graduation rate?
We're up around 97.
So kind of in plain terms, what's driving the increase for Whately this year?
Students.
Number of students.
Yep, she went from 9 to 12. So
in the formula.
Students went up 33% in your assessment to Franklin Tech went up about 33%.
So if our enrollment continued to go up at Franklin Tech, we would expect the assessment to continue to go up?
Yep, it's a per pupil base.
Per pupil base.
Our formula is in the district, and the state formula is per pupil base too, so.
Okay.
You need a different zip code.
All right.
So there are some smaller towns, for instance, that have gone up from 100%. They had 3 students, and this past year they got 6.
Right.
So they went up twice as much.
Yep.
It just kind of depends on the town.
Understandable. Any further questions, comments?
Very good report.
Thank you very much for the presentation.
Thank you.
We'll save Brad back.
And we'll send out the letter next year, so we'll keep you up to date.
It's good. I have
an age on that.
Amy probably can do that.
I'll just compare that presentation to
Frontier.
Did I say Frontier?
No, I didn't.
Okay. He said it.
I was thinking we need commercials for the other schools like that.
Right.
I did that on iMovie.
Yeah. Can you go up the road here and do one for that school? Take some pictures.
How old is Franklin Tech?
It is 44 years old.
Okay.
So, and I think we're the last building in the county not to get a major renovation, so we're trying to keep it up to speed as much as we can, so.
By any chance, if municipalities were to contact you, is there any sort of outreach program for your students? Let's say we wanted to have lights put in somewhere. Right? Is that?
That's what we do.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's good.
They do that stuff all the time.
Okay.
Is there lights for the
car? And there's not any labor associated with it, so the savings is monumental.
What's the
wait list?
We'll keep that.
They do. They love to work on the police guys because they figure they might get away with something down the road.
All righty. Well, next up would be Tri-Town Beach. We don't want to make Bill sit through the police thing because, he's got to get home too. Come on. Bill, thanks for coming in. We have Bill Skrowski here, who, what's your title for?
Committee member.
Tri-Town Beach committee member.
Whately's representative.
Whately's rep.
All right. It looks like we're going to be going up $200, 222. Is that what you got?
Yeah.
Mainly just a little increase in to stay ahead of the minimum wage.
Things seem to,
There's been a lot of discussion concerning Tri-Town Beach from a number of perspectives. Who really runs Tri-Town Beach?
The committee.
The committee runs.
Yep.
Okay. And it's funded by two towns.
Correct. 77% Deerfield, 23% Whately.
Okay. And so when it comes to making changes, how does that occur?
Well, we do try to save up enough money from the gate receipts, because we do not receive any other funding than for manpower and insurance. So any improvements, upkeep, you know, miscellaneous, you know, the water testing, all that comes out of gate receipts. So as time goes on, we accrued monies, and then we throw it at what we need to do. We've put fences up because it is a bond, and you have liabilities. So we fenced as much as we could. We're safe on the east side because of the railroad. You know, that's private property. So on the west side, south side, we fenced it. That all came out of gate receipts, over little by little. Brought in sand, replaced roofs, plumbing, wheelchair ramp, you know, as we have the funds, we, you know, make up a list of it. We got other things that need to be done, but you have to wait along until you have the funds to do it. You know, we haven't come to the towns for any capital expenses, as far as I know.
Now, do you keep track of how many Whately residents?
Yes, we do.
And what does that look like?
Well, the numbers are down because in the 80s, when 2.5 came in, you had very little going on, so that we had the only game in town, you know. So, you know, we're number wise, we're down. We're pretty much similar to what our proportion is, 23 to, you know, could be 19% of the eight in Deerfield, could be, you know, 81, you know. I mean, it varies depending on any season or not, you know.
But anyone can use a facility as long as they pay to go in, right?
No. The it was relatively kept to Whately and Deerfield.
Oh, yeah.
And then in the 80s, they added Sunderland mainly to generate money for the swim program, you know, because they were interested in the swim program. So we allowed, at that time, we allowed Sunderland only the families that were taking swim lessons. Then a few years went by, and then they added, let Sunderland come in, all of them, but they pay a higher fee. You know, right now they're paying like $50 a family, and we're paying like $35. And plus seniors, we charge seniors 10. Then we added Conway when their pond was, or when their pool was down.
Right.
We had a lot of Conway people for a period of time, but now they're back on deck, so that evaporated. Maybe 10, 12 years ago, we were approached by Hatfield. So some Hatfield people were interested in coming. Some organization came in, because I think Book Park went out of business. They had a pond, they filled it in, whatever. So. But their numbers are down, you know.
Yeah.
Because I think with the growth of the rec, you know, all the recs, you know, the Deerfield has a fantastic thing. They got a lot of things going on in the summer. So that our numbers are down as far as attendance. But we do have, we take their camps. They pay a fee to us for bringing a group in at noontime to 3.
Yeah. What about water quality? What's the story?
Well, the water, the testing last year was as best as it's been. We've had some problems in the past where they would have we'd have to shut down because of the figure would you know, and then open up, you know, you have to test until it goes down to a certain threshold to reopen. But we haven't had one of those in maybe 3 or 4 years. But the only thing going on now is we have some sort of a weed that's growing at the north end, and it goes through some kind of death thing, and it floats into the south. So we got the staff out there scooping this stuff out. It's like seaweed. It's like crazy, which is affecting our budget because, you know, we have to have them come in a couple hours early because it's really, I mean, it's like, like, you know, something out of a whatever.
Well, what about programs there? Any, you guys discussing any new programs to have?
We don't have the funding, you know, for anything new. Yeah. We only just have the funding for protecting, you know, the lifeguards and some maintenance. Right. And, there's no.
Yeah, but if you had, if you thought about programs, for instance, personal watercraft, you could have, you know, there are a lot of kayaking places around here that may come in during the summer and say, hey, maybe we can work something out here where people could take it out. Or, but if you had those kind of programs and you were thinking about that, then you'd come here and you'd say, guess what? We want 10,000 more because we're going to have these programs going on during the summer that we think the community can benefit from. Yeah.
Well, that's refreshing because it's been not like that. It's been usually level fund or cut.
Well, this is, take away the recent virus scare. This is the best economy in our lifetime ever. Yeah. And if you don't take advantage of this economy now, then it's going to be tough when things turn, if they turn. So, you know, I'll bring that up. You know, I would think as a committee member, you might want to bring this to the group and say, hey, let's start thinking of some stuff we can offer. Because if you start offering those other things, then you might have people coming back for just the regular swim.
Yeah, I'm in agreement.
You know, it's sort of...
Yeah, we're always open to new ideas, but
So who administers it? Deerfield administers all the...
Yeah, the Deerfield treasurer does all that. The banking and all that.
Okay. What have you done for advertising? Do you advertise at all for the place to get people there to know it's there? What are you doing?
We usually just do within the two towns. We don't go any further. You know, put a pamphlet out that we're open. You know, doing the television thing, you know, that we have, you know, the two towns. Yeah. We don't go any further than because it's always been they wanted to keep it within the two or three, you know, the group. We don't allow anybody other than the four top, you know, that I mentioned. No Northampton, no.
But if you opened it up to say make it a regional facility and charge more or get more participation.
I don't know how that works because under the charter, you know. The arrangement that we have when we was created.
Just for the four towns?
Well, it was the three towns originally, but Sunland didn't make the grade. The way the budget works is just the two towns.
Yeah.
Can I ask a quick question?
Sure.
Has there any thought been given to a nice sign on 116?
Neon?
I know what you mean, that's something. But like I know that there's like a new wooden one that's a little bit set back.
Yeah.
In terms of the road, I mean, at some point, I think there was like a plywood sign or something that's just open. Is there something we could,
there was always a thought of that, but we don't have any property out there. You'd have to talk to the state. They own most of the...
Yeah, we could do that.
You know. I mean, and then, you know, the state has their regulations.
And how high it can be.
It'll be fine. Well, I mean, something goes up now on the utility pole, right?
Yeah, so. We usually put open.
Yeah. Open what?
Try to tell me to open.
And then the question, what was the reasoning for the fence around the pond?
Liabilities, because a pond is like a pool.
Do you remember anybody going on there?
A pond is like a pool.
Well, a swimming area.
Not that one, other ones.
So you have four lifeguards? Three or four?
Well, we have three on duty at a certain period of time, then two on duty. But, you know, you're open 7 days a week, so there's more than four lifeguards.
Yeah. How many do you have to have at one time? Like, does the state tell you what you have to do?
No. No, we don't. I mean, if you got a large, you know, if you're going to have a large, you would put an extra person on.
Yeah. All righty.
And your committees, there's what, two reps from Whately and two from Deerfield?
Well, there's supposed to be three, but we're shorthanded.
Okay. Have you ever thought of coordinating with, say, rec departments of each town to see if they could help you with any kind of activities or?
Well, like I say, we do get the camps from the Deerfield rec. You know, they have their program during the summer, and they'll send their people down to our area.
Yeah, but I mean, we have a recreation commission, I guess it's called, right?
Yeah.
And I assume Deerfield does. Have you done any coordination with them or information sharing with them to inform them of what you're doing and maybe they could help you get money for whatever things you need? I mean, there's CPA and other money that's available for recreational activities. And this, I can say for sure, probably would qualify for some activity there if you reached out to them and got support for them. But I guess it's a matter of you coordinating or your organization coordinating with them. And I don't know whether that would start with Whately's or with Deerfield's or
okay,
whatever.
Okay, we'll look into that.
I think you may need, that may give you support for doing more or at least maintaining what you have and improving what you have.
Yeah, I'll tell you, one of the surprising things, and you know, through the years, your kids, my kids, we've all been involved in summer camps, you know, around the area and even at Frontier. You know, Frontier runs a lot of summer camps, basketball camps, softball camps. I rarely hear of, after the camps, you know, when everybody's running around, it's summertime and you're hot, thinking about going down to Tri-Town Beach. You know, they just, for whatever reason, it's not a draw. And I mean, it could be. You know, it could be a real nice place. Not that it's not a nice place, it could be a nicer place. So we see it as a resource. We'd like to see it create better stream of income than what's there now. So, you know, anything you can think, anything you can do to get that going, I think would be good. And the budget could go along with it. Any other questions? Any other thoughts, comments? Right now, everything looks good, Bill.
Thank you.
See you.
Yep.
I don't remember anybody going. Really? Not that old. You're working out.
Not that one. Some of the other ones.
The last piece of the program will be our police department.
Okay, so if I could, because JP's here, representative from the fire department.
Yeah.
If we could start with the capital item, just so you guys understand, as far as the radio request that we're looking at.
Okay.
Not sure what pages that might be on.
I'm not even.
It's on the capital planning committee report, and this is for the for your radio request.
Okay. It's on the way to capital improvement plan.
Yeah.
Common one.
Change.
The amount has changed.
The amount has changed.
So it's on the way up.
It has not gone south.
It has not gone yet. So I'll give you a brief history, and then JP's worked on some numbers.
Okay.
He came up with the spreadsheet based on some recent proposals that the state gave us for funding. So just a brief history. I'm not sure if everybody's aware of what's going on with the system, but. So back in 2003, 2004, we came up with a new radio system. It was the Franklin County radio system, which is currently what we're using. So unfortunately, at the time, in order to keep costs down, which we found out years later, in order to keep costs down, the way it was presented with the equipment that was needed to create the system and build the system, at that time we were using the equipment that they got was kind of less than state of the art at the time. It was probably, electronic technology was probably 2 or 3 years older than it should have been at the time. So as the years have gone on, so probably starting maybe 8 years ago, we started having some real problems with the radio system. So we started having issues because around the county, there's 13 towers with antennas for police and fire on them. So those antennas started having issues. They started seeing problems within communities with radios starting to have issues. They started having, at each tower site, there's computer components and electronic components and radio components and all that stuff. All that stuff started kind of breaking, essentially, because one, it was older, and two, the use of the system. It wasn't originally built, and the information that we have is it wasn't originally built for what we've used it for. So we've kind of overused the system in a sense. So fast forwarding to about 3-4 years ago, we really started seeing issues with the system to the point where the Franklin Regional Council of Government started having meetings, and they told us at those meetings, listen, everybody, police, fire, EMS, anybody that's using this system, within the next few years, you've got to do something because we're not going to support the system anymore. That Franklin County Regional Council of Governments being the fiscal agent, the one responsible for everything, we pay an annual fee, every town pays an annual fee into it, and they maintain it. So that annual fees continue to go up because we have to buy more and more equipment. The equipment that we're, the point we're at now, the equipment that we're using, they're actually looking for stuff on eBay. They're robbing from one tower to keep another tower going.
No joke.
Really?
It's like
used equipment. Yeah.
We're checking the pulse because we're waiting for it to die. That's kind of the point it's at now. So that brings us to about 2 years ago, they told us we've got two options. We had a meeting, and we have a couple of options. You can either build your own new radio system, which is going to cost millions and millions upon millions of dollars, and that's going to be on the town's dime to do that. Or we can look at jumping in with what the state police are using. That's the Commonwealth of Massachusetts interoperable radio system. They call it Commerce. So we started looking at that as kind of a better option. That system already exists. The infrastructure is already there. They have to make some improvements to it, but the infrastructure is already there. State police are using that system, and there's some towns in Hampshire County that are also using that system. So that brought us to, say, the last year. There's a committee together, our radio oversight committee. They've been meeting with the state as far as the Executive Office of Public Safety, the Executive Office of Technology, Training and Technology. They've been meeting with this all the way up to the governor's desk, and they've, across the state, committed to this project. So everybody on the emergency services side said, this is the route that we're going to go, so let's look at how much this is going to cost. So about 2 years ago, when they told us the radio system was going to die, I sent a proposal to the Capital Planning Committee. Not sure how far it went, but there was about $137,000 for radios, for us to purchase radios for police and fire. So that was a couple of years ago in anticipation that this may die soon, so we're going to need some money. They put out a couple of RFPs. They got the final one. Everything's kind of in place from the state's perspective. And this is the information that JP has as far as how many subscriber units, meaning radios, that each town is going to be allocated for, the price, you know, the cost for that radio. So we have the cost of the radio, what the state's going to pay, and what it's going to cost us. Initially this year, when I did the $10,000 proposal, we were told at that time that you're going to be given radios and you just have to pay for installs. Installs are, you know, $100 a piece, and you may have to buy some other miscellaneous stuff. So budget for that. That's literally what I had for figures. We decided with police and fire, it makes sense to do it as one thing as opposed to us doing our own thing and the fire department doing their own thing. It's the same radio system. So with that, the RFP that came out, that's the information that JP is going to present to you, so you have the actual numbers to it. But before we do that, do you have any questions on the system itself?
Way above my pay grade.
Okay. It's complex.
It's very complicated, but the bottom line is, both on the police and fire side, obviously, we need good communications for, it's a safety issue. We obviously know that the police, when Chief Savini or one of his officers are out by themselves, if they ask for help, they need somebody to hear them. Same thing on the fire side, you know, if we have somebody that's in a building and, you know, they need help, somebody, we need somebody to hear them. Or if somebody is responding to a call and they want to give an update on something, we need that message to be clear and for everybody. So, I mean, obviously, we need good communications. And the system that we have now is certainly failing. So the couple of variables that we have in the numbers that I'm going to show you in just a moment here, one of them...
Pass this around so they can go along with you.
Chief, let's pass these around there. I think they're a little bit...
Okay.
Are those easier to read? The bigger?
It looks a little bit bigger. Yeah. Do we have enough of them yet?
I think so. So when the project rolled out, there was a survey that went out to the police and the fire departments to try and assess how many radios the project was going to entail. And these aren't just numbers that were thrown out there. They're actually numbers based on the number of seated positions in the fire apparatus, the number of department members, and other factors like that. And they're based on national standards. So the fire department has been allocated on the grant side of things, they've been allocated 15 portable units, that's the handheld radios, and 6 mobile units. So the numbers that you're gonna see on...
Do you have one?
Yeah, I need one of those. The numbers that you're gonna see on the spreadsheet here, there's 2 columns that are tallied to the right. One of them is highlighted, the subtotals are highlighted in yellow, and the one to the right is highlighted in orange. Don't be alarmed by the ones in orange. It says non-subsidized costs, because that's, if we were to do this project on our own without state participation, that's what it would cost us. And you can see it's like roughly $120,000 project. And we're looking at somewhere in the neighborhood of $43,000. So you see we've broken it down to the cost of the radios. Cost per unit is the amount that we're gonna pay over and above what the state is subsidizing. So they're paying for the partial cost of that particular radio that we're looking at. And there's some other ancillary costs like programming we can't get around. There is a chance that the state may be able to include programming on those radios when they're shipped, so we may save some of that. I've put a subtotal out on the right-hand side on some of these, not the big print one. And that's like roughly $2,300. So there's a chance we might have a $2,300 savings, but we won't know until the project is actually completed. So we've broken them down into the mobile units and the portable units. We need some spare batteries for the portables. That makes sense. The portable radios need microphones. We need to be able to clip them onto our turnout gear, and the officers need them on their shoulders. Some of the other issues that were items that we're looking at here are the digital repeater capable. So one of the issues that we see in some of the larger buildings with this type of radio, these 800 megahertz radios, is they have a hard time getting outside of metal frame buildings. These energy efficient buildings with the reflective coatings on the glass, it's like a big Faraday cage, they don't let radio signals out. It's not just this radio system, but it's something that we're seeing across the board. By having this card built into them, it allows us the opportunity to have a repeater system on site in one of the vehicles that will boost that signal for the portable radio so we can get out.
Just one quick thing while you're on that. So the radio system that we're using now, if I go into Yankee Candle, for example, I'm in the middle of Yankee Candle, I try to call out. They'll call and tell me, you know, you're scratchy, we can barely hear you, can you speak up? So we have that like staticky, can you hear me now type of thing going on.
Right.
With this radio system, it's a digital system, so it either works or it doesn't. So there is no in between, there's no static.
If you can't get out, if the radio signal's not strong enough, the radio will just beep. So it'll tell whoever's trying to call out that it's not working. But So there is an importance to have that capability built into those radios, so that's an added cost. A couple other costs you'll see is a gang charger or a base, a charging station for multiple radios or multiple batteries. Yep. So something that we would have in the police station and on one of our fire trucks. The third group subset that I have here says fire officer portables. And the reason I've included that is that's for three additional portable radios. And because that number brings their total higher than what we see on this sheet that we're being allocated by the guidelines, they won't be subsidized, so that's the actual cost of the radio that you're seeing there. That cost of the radio is still cheaper than if we were to go out in the market and buy it, because it's part of this bulk FRP.
Is that because we need more?
So yeah, I'll get to that one second. And the reason why this would be a nice thing for us to have is because the number of portables that we have right now would give the chief a portable for his car, it would give him a mobile for his car, mobile radios for the rest of our apparatus and a mobile base station, and it would give us a portable radio for every seated position in those vehicles, but it would leave us without portable radios for our assistant chiefs and our captains. So we would really like that ability to have a radio for those officers, because we won't have mobile radios in our personal vehicles at this point because of the cost of them. It'd give us a chance to respond to a scene and give an update, or to call in a scene, call in an incident or something like that. So we've broken that out as a separate subset, and that's roughly $10,000.
Those would be used like before the fire truck gets here.
Before the fire truck gets here, yeah.
An officer gets there to see what's going on.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, officers also act as incident commanders, and they're part of the command staff when it comes to the incident command. So if all the radios are taken up from the seated positions in the truck, they may not have the ability to talk to anybody because there's no radios left. So they would kind of need their own assigned radios for that purpose.
So there's a lot of numbers on the page, but the bottom line is we're looking at mobile radios and portable radios to affect better communication, because our system is failing. And in two or three years, the system that we have now is going to be gone. The latest reports that I have as far as the rollout is that we're going to be seeing these radios sometime between 6 and 18 months from now. There's a chance that the whole rollout will happen all at once, both in the police and fire side. There's a chance that it will still come out in phases like they had originally planned. That's something that's really beyond our scope of being able to give you better information on. That's happening at the state level.
What do they figure the lifespan of this system will be?
It's a good question. The system, I would anticipate the system to last at least 20 years. These radios that we're looking at are they're very well built radios. They're not the highest grade of rugged radios we could get. We could get more expensive, more ruggedized radios, but they're not necessarily consumer or just commercial versions. They're made for the industry, they're made for the fire service, they're made for the police service. People are telling me that they're expecting like a 20 to 30 year lifespan of some of these radios, which is something that we've seen in some of the older radios that we've had if we're able to take care of them. So it's not something that we're going to be doing. We're not going to be coming back here in 5 years saying that this system has failed.
The state's currently, because this is a state system, statewide system, the state's currently investing $125 million into this for infrastructure to build it out further. This system was originally designed, so if you go up the 91 corridor or go down Route 2 corridor, it's designed to work within 2 miles of 91. That's the way they originally spec'd it out for the state police, because that's usually the area that they cover. So now they have to build it out a little bit further than that to accommodate all the other towns. So they, like I said, they're investing $125 million into this. They have an agreement with Verizon and FirstNet and AT&T to use their tower locations to put up antennas, which will give us better coverage. So moving forward, there's going to be more hundreds of millions of dollars towards this system. So it's not. We're not going to be putting in five-year-old technology to start with. This is going to be a huge investment.
And these are radios that initially the features won't all be utilized, like they can actually be built upon. And the intent of the system, and the reason why it's called an interoperable radio system is that if we do have a major incident somewhere, you know, we have task forces where we respond to different regions if there's some big incident going on, we'll be able to talk to people in other communities and they can respond here and talk to us. And it will really alleviate a lot of the issues that we have, you know, if we're, you know, in New Hampshire County, you know, that we have right now. That's the goal of the program, is to facilitate communications.
I'm not sure I understand the difference between mobile and portable. I mean,
sure.
A phone to me is portable. You take it anywhere
yeah.
you want. What's the distinction?
That's a legitimate question. So, so portable radio, something...
I left mine in the car, but it's got the mic that he clipped on.
Something like the sergeant's got right here.
Yeah.
That's his portable radio. He can carry it with him into a building. The mobile radio is actually physically mounted in the vehicle.
But why can't he use that in the vehicle?
For a couple of reasons. One of the reasons is for the police, because having a radio transmitting close to their head, it's like having the radar right in front of them. They're actually showing that it's not healthy for people. And you also get a better signal having an antenna outside of the vehicle than you do inside. And it's safer to be able to use the radio the way it's mounted inside the vehicle, as opposed to using the radio that's on your on your shoulder.
So the radio, the portable radio is about 3 watts. You're putting out about 3 watts. The mobile radios, you're putting out 10 to 12 watts. So you're putting out almost three times the amount of power. So if you're on a mobile radio calling in a motor vehicle stop, if you're at a fire scene calling on your way, you're gonna have better coverage with the mobile radio. So that's part of the repeater system is gonna tap into our cruisers and fire trucks to be able to push from a mobile radio or from a portable radio to the mobile and then out to our dispatch. So we really need, it's a kind of a three-phase thing. We've always had, and they've always had portables and mobiles. If I'm on a portable, I'm out of the car. If I'm in the car, then I'm using the mobile. Yeah. Portables they have batteries. The way they are now, we're lucky if we make it through a shift with the portable. The mobile radios are hooked up into cruisers all the time, so they're constantly working off battery power.
Yeah, every time they start the cruiser, the radio comes on.
So then why does these officer need a portable? He's either in a cruiser or in the office, I guess. And if he gets a call somewhere, I mean, you're not going to have 8 officers go all at once.
I agree with that.
All at once, right?
I agree with that part also, but
How does that make sense? I don't know. Having each officer, whether he's there or not, or home or not on duty, having a portable, but he's not using it because he's not on call, and the ones on call are going to have a portal, a mobile when they get there. I mean,
it's kind of similar to looking at, say, a cruiser. If we're the amount of shifts that we're covering per day, if we use one car, we're going to be replacing cruisers way more often than we do now. If we use one portable and share it with everybody, we're going to be buying more portables at the cost of $4,000, $5,000, $6,000. On a regular basis. But these radios will allow us, the amount that we have now, we can currently assign it to 2 officers. So 2 officers are responsible for that one radio. So they use that radio. The other 2 officers will use another radio. The other 2 officers will use another radio. And we do have times where we have incidents. If there's something going on, if we have parades, there are times where we're using all the radios. There's times where we're looking for radios from other departments to use. The radios are important. We're not looking for a radio to assign to each individual person, which some departments are. They're looking to assign a radio to each person. If you assign a radio to one person, that one person's using it, the lifespan of that radio is gonna be much, much longer. So it's better to invest it now at the cost of $549 a radio than to do it down the road at a cost of $6,000 or $7,000 a radio.
So who's gonna get the 8 portables? I mean, you only have 2 officers
two
on duty, or 3 of the most. What's happening with the other 5?
You're gonna sit on the shelf.
They're on the shelf?
They're going to sit on the shelf till that next person works his shift. If we had one or two radios, those are going to be used every day, all the time, getting used and abused all the time. So if we have a radio assigned to each group of people, each two officers, it's the way it's always been. It's the way we have it now.
Yeah, but that doesn't make it right, Jim.
I'm not saying that then
doing it that way doesn't make it right. You understand that?
Well, I understand that. But show me a town that doesn't do that.
I don't care what other towns do.
Yeah. Well, I do because this is for us. This is our communication. If we have one radio and that goes down, what are we going to do? We don't have another radio.
I'm saying we don't need eight.
Or even 15 for fire.
I was just looking at that. That's ridiculous. Yeah. There aren't 15 firefighters in this town, are there?
No. And if they are, how many respond?
How many respond?
Yeah, five. So
yeah.
So I can address that issue on the fire side. The number of portables that we're looking at, if we break it down, you know, do you want to take the officers' portables out of the mix for now?
Sure. Just talk about fire on them.
Yeah.
So we'll just talk about the fire apparatus then. So if we respond in one vehicle to a fire scene, generally speaking, the standard across the nation is when a vehicle is set up and equipped for response, it's set up to respond with people in every seat. And that's a national standard. It's an NFPA standard.
And what's reality?
Which is what, four in our vehicles? Six?
It depends. Some of our vehicles have seating for three. One of our vehicles has seating for seven. And that's where these numbers have come from. But we can't realistically expect people, if you're going to be responding to one piece of apparatus, to go into another fire truck and take radios out of that fire truck and take this one.
If you're responding, if you're in a fire, why are you on the radio then?
Because you're in the building fighting a fire.
Every fire.
Where's the chief in all of this?
That's a widely accepted national standard for safety. That every firefighter is assigned a portable radio when they go into a building.
And how many firefighters are there currently?
I think your roster was 23 last John told me, 22, 23.
I don't have that number in front of me.
That's the last he told me a few months back.
So then it'd be like a pecking order. Who gets the 15?
Who showed up?
Who's in the seats? I mean,
okay, so these would be at the station.
It'd be in the truck.
Yeah. They're in the truck. That's why they're assigned to the vehicles. They're assigned to seated positions, and they would be physically mounted in the truck. So we wouldn't have a wall full of stuff.
So when you show up to a fire, and you leave the truck, you take it with you, and you go into a building or
that fire truck is ready to go. Like we wouldn't buy breathing apparatus, and you know, based on the number of firefighters we have, we would buy them based on the number of seats in the fire trucks that we can use that truck to maximum efficiency. I mean, that's really that's really important safety standard nationally. And in fact, some of these safety standards, if we were to violate these standards and not have a portable radio in somebody that's in a building, and there was an incident where that person was injured or killed, there are serious repercussions.
Sure.
because we're not following a national standard.
Yep. And all of a sudden, this price looks very inexpensive.
That's why I included the number on the right. I mean, I know $42,000 is a lot of money.
Yeah.
$120,000 is a lot of money, and that $120,000 number is still cheaper than it would be if Chief Savini was to put these numbers together a year ago without going off the state bid for these radios and getting that bulk price on them. The number would be much, much larger than that. So you know, we're kind of looking at strike while the iron is hot right now.
But just getting back to that, fire officer portables.
Yes.
Above that you got fire, you got 15, 542 per. But under the officer portables, they're non-subsidized.
Right.
So there's really I mean, we don't have to jump on that now, because that price is going to be out there.
Exactly.
You know, when this whole bid process is over, it's still going to be the same thing.
So that's why I broke that out as a separate line item in there.
Yep.
And my understanding, and Chief Savini, I think you got a pretty concrete answer on this, that these prices are going to be good for 2 or 3 years?
Yeah, this contract's for 3 years. So okay. these prices are good for 3 years.
After three years,
they're going to at least double it out.
So if we had to break that out and do that, you know, at another time.
We're talking about.
Yeah. For now, you know, we can, that's someplace where we would willing to make a concession on this list.
So how does this, the type of radios you're using here tie in with the ambulance service? Is it going to be compatible? Are they looking the same things or what?
Yes, they are. So all the emergency services are essentially going over to this, to the system. Unless you're in a municipality where they have their own radio frequency and they're maintaining their own radio system, this is really what's going to happen. You can either get on this bandwagon.
How many towns will be involved with this?
For 3 years. How many towns?
Yeah.
I'm my understanding that most towns are jumping on it. Some of the larger communities that already have a larger investment in their systems, Springfield and Amherst.
How would this compare to like Hatfield and Williamsburg? Are they going to do the same thing?
Yeah.
They're already doing the same thing. They got money last year to purchase radios.
Yeah, but it's not online yet, so how could they be doing it?
It is online. This, like I said before, the system is online. They're just putting $125 million into building it out. We don't have radios, so they came up with this plan to give us the opportunity.
So the system's out there, but not you don't have the radios to do it.
Correct. Okay. This is all about subscriber units. This isn't about the infrastructure, building the system, antennas, that kind of stuff.
And they don't have the bandwidth, essentially, right now, is my understanding, for everybody to jump on at once.
So what will be the time frame for you to jump on?
The latest number they're telling us is probably early fall. But that, like JP said before, they could turn around tomorrow and say, yeah, we found all the radios, we got them, here they are, we'll send you an invoice, come pick them up, and then we can move on it quicker.
Who installs them?
there's a couple of different companies that they have state bid pricing for installations, and those are the prices we have to look at for installs. We're looking at what, $72 for a mobile and $54. Those are the programming price. So the installation prices, those are what we're responsible
those
for.
Those are broken out down at the bottom.
Yeah, so he's got them on the bottom of the sheet for installations.
And those are estimates, you know, it's an hourly rate, so so when that person comes in, when that group comes in, that this is like a ballpark figure for that. It might be lower.
Okay, go back to my question about the ambulance service. So does GEMS have these radios now, or it's in their budget?
They're going to be part of this same program.
I'm asking you, do they have them now?
Do they have them now?
No, they don't have the ability to purchase these radios on this system yet.
So when will they be?
As soon as we do. It's all part of the same program.
This is part of a
state bid. It's all rolling out at the same time.
They have offered to us.
SCIMS not on here because this is police and fire.
I know,
and
but is that in this part of the SCIMS budget? Have we seen that yet? I don't know.
Well, SCIMS
has been here.
They haven't been here yet.
They have. It's all broken down.
And have they talked about radios?
He may have.
About new ambulances.
Yeah.
I'm not sure. I can't recall the conversation.
I assume this is going to be like, basically, I know how the old system works. It's going to be like the old system.
Right.
Only it's going to be, you're going to have better coverage.
You're going to be higher.
You're still going to, you know, Franklin County Police are going to be on, I don't know, Channel 1. And fire is going to be on the same frequency, but on Channel 2 or whatever it is. And South County might be on Channel 3.
Yeah, so this system is a lot more complicated.
It's more satellite-based, wouldn't it be?
No, it's not satellite-based, but it's, I mean, it may as well be. It's pretty complex. It's a trunk system, is my understanding. So there's, it's, you know, the radios are smart. The radios are always talking with their radios, their towers they're communicating with to find out where they're getting the best strength from and which frequency they're going to be transmitting on. And I think ultimately, my understanding is that the control will be able to assign us a channel. So if we had a fire in the center of town, they could say, go to channel 2, and that's your
Whately police and fire could be on the same channel.
We could be able
to. Which you can't do now.
They're two separate channels.
Right, two separate channels.
Two separate frequencies.
But we, yeah. My understanding,
you can sit in a car and
I can switch to channel 2.
We would still be able to communicate, is my understanding.
Yeah, yeah.
So they can assign you the channel, and then to get
for an incident,
a better signal, they can assign you another channel. Say you won't be on the same.
I don't think it will necessarily change the signal. What they're trying to do is avoid too much radio traffic
on the same
one radio. Yeah. Because you know, we can only listen to one conversation at a time on a radio, you know, and whether it's a dispatcher, you know, or somebody in the field, and one he might be trying to get an important message across, and somebody's talking about, you know, a traffic stop
in Sunderland,
and he might have, you know, an active shooter situation, so he's going to have his own channel assigned to him. So there's a lot of things that are built into the system. I'm not well versed enough to explain it all.
There's going to be about 800 channels programmed into all of these radios, because it's across the state. It's interoperability with MEMA and other agencies from, you know, down south to out east. I mean, theoretically, we could talk to Boston PD via these radios once it's all built out. So we'll have a bank of channels, 16 channels, one bank that we can assign whatever channels we want. Within those 800, we can assign the police channel, the fire channel, two or three tactical channels, maybe a talk around channel, maybe, you know, EMS on the same one. So we can pre-program 16 channels. If not, then we'd have to switch zones, and it gets a little bit more complicated.
So this doesn't really pertain to it, but just say you had a big incident in Hatfield, and they had channel 4, and then you responded, and could you flip to channel 4 and meet? Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, that's the interoperability part. Yeah. Right now, we can't talk to Hatfield at all, and we back them up. They back us up more than any other agencies, and there we can't even talk to them on the radios.
It just, I mean, the current system is dying. It's a safety issue. The state is throwing out a boatload of money. If we're not smart enough to take advantage of that, it's shame on us. And well, that's how I see it.
And I understand it's a lot of information to take in at
once.
It's
a lot of information in a short period of time, yeah.
Yeah. You know, it's a lot of information for us to try and digest, to give to you, so I understand that it's a lot for you to take in all at once, too. You know, the one thing I would say, which I think we talked about already, if we make a concession on you, because I know that $43,000 is a lot, if we could maybe, you know, another capital year while we're still on this FRP, try and get those additional portables.
Yeah.
That's something that would definitely be used. And, you know, as far as the portables go, all I can say once again is just that they're really important for people to be able to talk when they're not within eyesight of each other. You know, it sounds obvious, but there's a lot of times where we might be out and we might have a bunch of people out, and you know, we don't know when the next microburst comes through, and we don't have any phone service in town. You know, or when the next tornado comes through, instead of Conway, it's here, and he's got all of his people out, and we've got all of our people out. You know, we're preparing for the worst case scenario.
It's a safety issue.
So,
for you and for the community. Yeah. So. Anybody have any further questions for JP or the chief on the radio?
It irritates me that, you know, last year we talked about doing it for 10,000. This year, initially in here for 10,000. Now it's in here for 43. That just irritates me.
Well, short term.
Yeah, us as well. We get numbers as they come out. You know, they tell us one thing, and then 6 months later, they tell us something else. 2 years ago, it was 137,000, and then went to 10. So it's all over the place. This is the only concrete numbers that we've actually gotten at this point.
And when they were supposed to pay for transportation, too.
Yeah, I know.
So those things go away.
So if you're going to do this over, what, 2 years, what would it?
I feel better about it doing it over 2 years.
Just half, or is there a different?
I don't think that's going to happen.
No, but would it be half, or would you just do one department first and the other? How would you split it 2 years?
Well, you, realistically, you need to should know when it rolls out. I mean, that's the.
We can put the 43,000 in there and sit there for 2 years.
That's right. That's
what they don't even know when it's going to be ready.
Oh, okay.
I mean, if you do say
they only know it at a state level, they're the best guess around 6 months.
And it could come out be half of what it, you don't know. But in this economy, I would bet that it's going to be the full boat. So I would think.
The one thing that I have been reassured of is that this money, the money that they've subsidized, is there at the state level. That part is done. That's ready to go. It's just a matter of building it out, and there's some contract issues at the state level that are.
So just to let you know, JP, we don't vote on this here and now.
Yeah.
We have a meeting at the end of the process, and we look at all the budgets, and we review all the budgets and vote on each budget individually, and in coordination with Brian, what the numbers are, AKA tax rate.
Right, so for sure. And if you want more information, I'll be happy to try and find, if you have specific questions, I'll be happy to try and, you know, be able to ask some specific questions. I know you've got contacts too, you can get some answers too for us.
We will find the answers if we don't have them.
Okay, thank you very much.
All right,
appreciate it.
Sorry we didn't have a PowerPoint or a movie for you.
What's your fire recruiting video?
Recruiting video.
Yeah. I wait to see the guys in turnout gear, and you know,
they try to do calendar ones.
I don't want to see them. Although, let me tell you, if you have a fire at your house, you want to see them.
I know, but I don't want to make a commercial. Having a fire just to make a commercial.
All right, thank you for your time.
Thank you, Elder.
Okay, next, let's get to the actual. No, it's here.
Boy, the actual police budget level funded for this year. There's no increase in the operating expense. And like every year, we just use last year's numbers, or the current year's numbers for salary stuff. And if that goes up, then it gets added later on. But there's no increases to this year's budget.
Do you have any questions? Thank God you're here. Okay. At the bottom. All right. Okay, no increase. All right. How come?
The way the budget sits right now, as far as training and everything goes, there haven't been any increases in the requirement for the training.
Yep.
Equipment-wise, I don't think we're in, other than a radio system, I don't think we're in need to do any major upgrades to the equipment that we have in the station. So I don't see a need to increase anything. Postage, I mean, that's always a thing that kind of steadily goes down. We don't, it's only $20 or $30 here or there, but that's just a number. We don't even purchase stamps anymore. We use the town system, and money will come out of our budget for things that we have to mail. Most things are electronic these days, so all of our submissions for incident reports, state stuff, crash reports, all the things that we have to submit to the state, all of that's done electronically online, so we hardly have to mail anything at this point. Our part-time officer,
budget and training. We've made some changes in the training. There's one or two classes that we're able to do online now, as far as our training that they offer each year. So that's reducing the wear and tear on the car, having to drive down to the academy, the expense for, you know, fuel and all that stuff going down there, paying officers for the full time. We do the majority of the training in-house, so there's a couple classes that we offer online. So we still have to pay for them to sit there and do the training. We're just providing the training instead of sending them out of the station or out of the department. So again, no new initiatives, nothing that can't be covered with the current budget.
Yeah.
Office supplies, heat. I mean, we look at heat and electricity as, you know, the commodities that they go up, they go down. So it's always kind of a crapshoot. I think we've reduced that a couple of times because the number was initially a little bit high because we weren't sure. A few years back, we started paying our own bills as opposed to coming out of town buildings. So we started paying our own electricity, our own heat, internet, all those things are not really on our budget. So we have a pretty good grasp on what our electricity bill is going to be, what our heating bill is going to be, and, you know, there hasn't been any huge dramatic increases in those things. Last year, we made some upgrades to the station. We put in motion sensor lights, so the lights don't get left on, so our electric bill is more consistent than it was when we see a lot of fluctuations, people leaving lights on, some things like that. So a couple little changes that we made.
Yep.
In that sense. So always trying to figure out the best way to squeeze the penny. Some of the things are just unknowns. You know, we just don't know. Firearms, ammunition, you know, things like that. We kind of have an idea of what each officer is required to spend each year, but we don't know if something major is going to happen, or we're going to have to bring in, you know, multiple officers to cover an incident. Those things have happened. We've had those incidents, those storms where we've got six or seven people working at a time. So those things do occur.
So with,
thankfully, not too often. But
should that new communication equipment come in, would the communication equipment here come out of this budget? Well, the $1,000. I mean, it's only $1,000, but that's for
communications.
Cell
equipment.
Phone, MDT card.
No, that's not for maintenance on the equipment. That pays for our mobile units that we have in the cruiser. That pays for the air cards on those.
Gotcha.
And you know, maintenance agreements, things like that. So what will change eventually, not for the next couple of years, but that FERCOG regional communication assessment.
Yeah.
That's currently what we pay to keep our system going, the annual maintenance fee that we have now. They're telling us that they're gonna continue running the system, mm-hmm, for the next couple of years until this all rolls out with the new communication system. So maybe a couple of years from now that number will drop as well, maybe sooner. We just don't know. That's the frustrating part about the time frame.
Sure. All right, any questions about that part of the budget? All right, Chief. Where are we going next?
We did have one other capital request that I'm just trying to find here, but I had it right on the top, but for the speed, the speed signs, radar signs that people have been requesting around town.
Yep.
And some improvements to the station. We've been into the building, it's $15,000 total. We've been in the building since 2008, September 2008, we moved in. So inside the building, you know, there's marks and nicks and stuff on the wall from different things. We move stuff around, there's holes, and it needs to be freshened up. It's been 12 years, and it's used pretty much 17, 18 hours a day. So
yeah.
I think it's time to at least do a little bit of touching up on it. the outside of the building, I've already got a list, excuse me, I've got a list going for Keith. There's a couple of things that need to be done to the structure. There's a whole section of block, you know, the mortar from inside the block, from the salt and stuff as they're going by plowing. There's a big chunk taken out of the building, so some repairs need to be made for that. Over the main entrance door, there's another spot above there. It's kind of a hole that's developed in there, so we need to just do some patchwork. And the possibility of, again, touching up the paint on the outside as well. Last time we did it, we used the Franklin County House of Corrections. We paid for the paint, they came down and they painted the building. We did the inside of the building, we being the police officers, I know Lynn was there helping us out. We did all the painting, priming and painting and the ceilings, walls. We did that before we initially moved in. That's also something that the Franklin County House of Corrections will do. We just have to move stuff and get everything ready for them. We have to have the supplies for them to come in and do the painting, so.
It sounds like Franklin County Tech.
That's an option as well, yeah.
Yeah.
It may be a better option, more community-friendly option.
Yeah.
I mean, we want to promote, you know, the people that are in the jail system to work and get out and learn a trade, do that kind of thing. But we also have students as well that could do it, so one of the two options. And either one of those options doesn't include labor, so. But that's the request for that. And looking at four speed radar signs. You've probably seen them. They're becoming a popular item in towns. You've probably seen them around Hatfield or Deerfield, around the areas. It's a speed radar sign. We have the mobile sign now. It's something that we have to lug up into a vehicle. We can't tow it. We have to pretty much load it in and out of the car. That's about 14 years old. That's, you know, it's got a battery in it, but that battery, it's a rechargeable battery. That's only lasting about a day and a half now, where it used to last like 4 days. So that's kind of getting to the end of its life cycle. And from the select board's perspective, I know they've had community members coming to the select board looking for ways of reducing traffic in addition to the enforcement.
Dump some gas on the road.
There you go.
Dump
some gas.
Hello, so, Jim, I seem, speaking of the signs, speed limit signs, I'm seeing more of these portable ones, and by that I mean it's just a unit that's mounted on a pole out there, like a sign pole.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen it around town. It's not something that's fixed to the ground or whatever.
Yep, that's what it would be.
I don't know if that's the kind you're looking for.
Yep.
Or not, that you could actually move from one location to another
very
easily.
Yeah, they're set up so they mount to like a telephone pole.
Yeah, right.
There's a solar panel unit
that
mounts on top, and then there's the actual radar sign unit that mounts on the bottom.
Right.
It's held on with a couple of straps for each device. We would need to use like a lift truck. The town's got the bucket truck. We can go up and that, take it down and move it to a different location.
Yeah.
It's not something that I would want to do on a weekly basis or a daily basis, because these signs also collect data. So we want to get a good assessment of data, number of cars. It's going to give us car counts, average speeds,
creepy
high speeds.
Stuff, kind of
creepy stuff. But yeah, the government watching you kind of stuff. Yeah, there's no cameras in them.
Not yet.
You're not going to get mailed a ticket if you go too fast on Chestnut Plain Road. You may get mailed one from an officer, but you won't get mailed one from that sign. So there has been a big push in talking with Deerfield, Hatfield, Sunderland, just the towns around us. They have seen some positive results from it. More in the way of the data that they're collecting, as opposed to just the number that appears on the sign. Because it gives them an idea of what time of the day do we need to be out there enforcing. When are cars going the fastest? When's the highest volume of traffic? You know, those are good numbers to have. And for the first year or so, if we get these, the first year or so, we might move them around to different locations so we can get a better idea of traffic and time frame wise. We all know that there's, you know, the big time frames, 6 o'clock in the morning, 2 o'clock in the afternoon, 10 o'clock at night when Yankee Candle's getting out, then you're getting 300-400 cars at one time racing around trying to get home. We're aware of those times, but you know, some of the other some of the other times. I mean, people tell us all the time, people speed on this road every day, all day long, they're speeding, and then we sit down there, and the, you know, the fastest car may be 48 and a 45. 48 by their house is way too fast for them, but it's only 3 miles an hour over the speed limit. And, you know, I would encourage the community to exercise what they're speaking of as well, because they complain a lot about speeding and stop sign violations, and then we sit there and we stop quite frequently stop the people that are complaining. That happens quite often. So we'd like to encourage that as well. But I think that, you know, just to be able to get the data off it would be a huge benefit, a huge plus. So.
Okay.
So that's that capital expense. Do you have any questions on that?
Anything else?
We are going to be reaching out to the public as well. We know the areas that people complain the most about, but if we do get these signs, if and when we do get them, we'll be reaching out for the community's input as well through social media and maybe a survey, other options there to find out, you know, where people might think that we'd want to put these signs. We know the center of town is kind of a hot spot for people that like to speed, Haydenville Road, River Road, so we know specific areas.
How will you know if $10,000 is an effective spend? You know, I mean, what's, you know, I know you're going to get data, and you're going to look at the data, and then, you know, if in fact there is a lot of activity in a given spot because of the data, you're going to put an officer there in a car with a gun.
Yep.
So therefore, we should be seeing
a radar gun. Not a rifle, not the rifle.
And a regular gun, and a sidearm.
We will not be displaying the sidearm.
And a portable phone.
Portable radios.
So,
radio. Okay.
I guess my point is, we should be seeing.
What's a benchmark? You know, what are your goals besides of data? What kind of data?
Well, the largest goal, the obvious, the big one is to hopefully slow people down. If that, because it does help when people see the number, most people will see that and say, I have to slow down. They've seen decline in speeding on certain areas of their towns, the towns around us. They've seen that information just based on the number display. So they've seen a reduction in speed and traffic. If it doesn't happen, then we're going to have to do the enforcement. We'll have the data, so we'll know the times to do the enforcement, and we may have to, we don't want to just go out and write tickets to everybody, but if this doesn't reduce it to the point that we feel is safe, then, you know, we'll have to use that data to do targeted enforcements and start issuing more and more citations.
It may help you with, if you want to change the speed limit, if you look at the 85th percentile of speeds going through there. And that's how you set the speed limit. So,
but it's one number.
It's one number.
It's traffic counts. It's the average speed.
Where you need to go up or down, well, then that's a good use of that data as well.
Yeah. And those speed limits currently are set by the state, so they have their formulas and the data. They input the data and then.
Right. But if you have the data to show people are exceeding it a lot or not exceeding it, and you want to adjust it, I guess you could use it.
I've heard from each town that I've talked to about these signs, I've heard just the stories about, you know, the residents that say, cars are flying by my house, there's this car, look, this car right here, give you the plate number, that car speeds by all the time. They're going 60 miles an hour down the street. They've got the sign up, they've got the counts, they've got all the speeds listed out, you know, 100 pages of data, and then the highest speed limit in the 35 zone is 42 miles an hour. So, you know, I think people honestly, legitimately think, I've seen people on the side of the road waving, yelling at people, slow down, I'm like,
really?
I'm behind them and they're going 45 in a 45. So people just think that they're going faster than they are a lot of times. So that's why the data is good, so we can look at it and say, well, you're saying people are, this person's going at 6 o'clock every morning, they're going 80 miles an hour. At 6 o'clock every morning, the highest speed is 34. And we'll have that data to be able to kind of support or disprove an argument somebody may have.
So. Gotcha. Any other questions, thoughts, comments, Jim, on this concern?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
I think that's
is that only, it?
Well, the only other thing I have is just the full-time officer request. think you guys have that information.
Yeah.
I've been meeting with Joyce. We've had some discussions about options that we can come up with. Ultimately, the request is for a full-time officer, but we've also added some options in there as well. But if I could, just to take 5 minutes of your time, I'd like to just read through the proposal that I gave. I know it's lengthy.
We've heard it all before.
Absolutely. And I know there's people that don't even look at it. So, because the questions that they ask are outlined in the data. So, I mean, if you guys don't want to hear it and you've already heard the information and you're comfortable with what
Can you summarize this for us, your need for an additional full-time officer?
It's difficult to just give a quick summary because there's so many factors behind it. So the summary is for the full-time officer, the increases that we've seen, and not so much in violent crimes. So I'm not saying that we've had all this violent crime, so we need to add people on there. There's been an increase because we are a fully functioning police department. We do our own investigations. We do our own crime scene investigations. We do photography for all crime scenes. We handle a lot of these things. We do our own training in-house. All of the items that I've listed on there, there's a lot of things that we're doing to provide the best quality service that we can for our community. So what happens, and the biggest reason, so to speak, is that I looked at this is because of the administrative aspect of things. So during the week, my 40-hour shift when I'm working during the week, it's come down to more than 20 hours a week that I'm spending doing administrative stuff, whether that's community outreach stuff, whether that's meetings, going out of town for meetings, going out of town for training, doing training with our officers, processing all of the state reports that we have to process, maintaining computer systems. We do all of that stuff in-house. So all of that administrative stuff takes away the ability to put somebody out on the road, to have them out enforcing the traffic, and not so much responding to calls, because if I'm in my office working on something, I'll absolutely respond to the call. I'll drop whatever it is.
Right.
But there's plenty of times throughout the month that nobody's even in town. I'm at a meeting in Greenfield. I could be at a meeting halfway across the state. So when those things happen, there's nobody in town to cover. People have asked, well, you know, we have the state police to cover. It's outlined in here a little bit. State police covers, I think it's 545 square miles. They cover between Franklin and Hampshire County, dozens of police departments that they may cover. There's a lot of towns in Hampshire County that don't have police departments that have the same hours that we have. So they're responding to a lot of their calls, overnight calls. Those departments aren't sending an officer to those. We're providing the service. So when you call 911, you have a Whately officer that shows up, that's more vested in the community, that has more of an interest and more of a commitment to the department, to the town, because it's their full-time job. We've always had part-time officers. We've always had part-time officers covering primarily the weekend shifts, because it's always a challenge to fill week shifts during the week with part-time officers, because most of them, the majority of them, have full-time jobs, so they do this on the weekend. They're not looking for three or four shifts during the week. They're looking for shifts on the weekends. So what happened last year, talking with the select board and explaining all these things, they voted to give an additional 4 hours per week for extra coverage, so we would have somebody during the week. That 4 hours was very difficult for me to fill, because people didn't want to come in and just work for 4 hours. They wanted to do a shift, so a lot of people wouldn't want to work the shift. So what we did is, instead of 4 hours a week, we did 8 hours every other week. So we've got 8 hours, a full shift, that's a little bit easier to fill. So that's what we currently have. So on the chart here, you see what the part-time shifts are, what they're actually covering currently. So I think everybody can see, it should have some red reduction numbers in there. It's two columns and then one big column in the center. Should be in your packets.
Okay. Yeah.
Got that. Okay, so looking at those numbers from the full-time officer's perspective, just going down the list here. So adding a 40-hour person per week, so we're looking at a salary of 44,720. So I came up with that 44,720, just looking at what other departments are hiring people at, what they're paying their officers, and kind of keeping it at a round number, 2150 per hour. That's, we came up with that 44,720 as a starting price. Some departments are much higher, some departments are a little bit lower, but that seems to be the, you know, the average starting price for an officer. Looking at the back side of the proposal, I think it's page 3 of the proposal, it breaks it down a little bit more, but that breaks down the benefits to the town, what the town's share would be for an employee plus one, a single person, a family plan. So taking that number and just looking at the largest number that the town would see, that's where the 16,361 number came from as far as the medical expenses at the town's cost. That wouldn't come out of, or that wouldn't be added to the police budget, but it would be added somewhere. I'm not sure which line or which budget it comes out of. Brian would know better than that, but it's gonna be an expense that's gonna come from somewhere. So I've reduced that because it won't be part of my budget. So our current total budget is $204,075. if we look at the schedule that I proposed, the option one schedule that we proposed, that reduces two part-time shifts, because the full-time officer would work into the weekend a little bit to cover one of the weekend shifts. So they're actually covering two shifts during the week, or I'm sorry, two shifts for the weekend. And then they would, the rest of the time they would be covering during the day, during the week. So that's what would give me the best opportunity to deal with the administrative stuff and have somebody out on the road, which I feel provides the best level of service to the community, to have somebody out there. So just continuing on looking at the numbers, it's a total increase after subtracting the part-time officers, a total increase of $25,126, which brings the overall budget, instead of $204,075, we're looking at $229,201, and that's getting us a full-time officer. So that's what I'm proposing, that's what I put in the proposal, that's what I feel would provide the best level of coverage and the best service to the community. In our discussions, there was some discussion about options. What options could we do so to keep the cost down more? So I added a couple other options of adding another 4 hours per week, which would give us 8 hours total per week. So I've got that number in there. Adding two shifts per week, so which would give us a little bit more coverage for the administrative stuff during the week. And then we also discussed a full-time equivalent position, which is would still be filled by a part-time officer, so it wouldn't necessarily be a full-time qualified police officer. So a full-time police officer, the current police academies that are going through are about 830 hours of training that they have to do there. Once they get out of there, if they come to our department, we would provide an additional 350 hours of training, field training. The Reserve Academy for part-time officers right now is right around 340 hours. So there's much more things that are included in the full-time academy. You're getting a more qualified person, a better qualified person, somebody that we can take, put in during the week, and I can delegate things on a regular basis that they could do. For a part-time officer, we may have one part-time officer working this Saturday. He may not work again for another 2 or 3 weeks. So to follow up on investigations, to plan out anything moving forward, community events, things like that, we have a hard time. We struggle with part-time officers, getting part-time officers to do this stuff because of their commitments. They work full-time and they don't want to commit every day of the week. They don't want to commit one shift a week. So that's kind of the struggle, and it's always been a struggle.
Yep.
And as long as we have part-time officers, it's going to continue to be a struggle. Some departments are even going as far as to get rid of part-time officers and just employ 5 or 6 full-time officers to cover all the shifts that they need. Then they have just full-time officers. They don't have to worry about the part-time officers moving around.
Why do we need a police officer doing administrative work?
Because the majority of the administrative work is my responsibility. So there are some things that could be delegated. There's some things that I delegate to Don now as a sergeant. So there's a list of things that his responsibilities are. But some of the responsibilities that I have, which would continue to be my responsibility, there are some other things that we could delegate to a full-time officer so we could alleviate even more of the administrative burden on one person. So I would be able to go out and patrol more and do more traffic enforcement as opposed to sitting in the station.
My point is, why can't we employ someone who's trained as an administrator who is a clerk, secretary, something along those lines to do, because unless it's double top secret and only for your eyes only, I can't imagine what could be so difficult that someone who's trained in the administrative area couldn't carry it out. Ultimately, this is the select board because you report to them. But as someone in this committee who has to look at a number and determine the value of that number and tell the residents of Whately that it's a good number. So we kind of have to satisfy that because other people are going to ask the same thing.
Yeah.
If I go around to all the police stations in Western Massachusetts, you tell me I'm never going to find clerks or secretaries or administrators that are not police.
Yep, no, you're absolutely going to find that, but you're also going to find multiple police officers on per shift.
Yep.
So an administrative person, although it would be helpful to have somebody with a payroll and doing things like that, those are limited times that we do that every other week, keeping track of the budget items. We can put somebody administratively in charge of that. But for Whately, it's just spending the money, investing the money to have an administrator sitting at the station that only can do administrative things. I don't think that's a benefit to the town. I don't think it's in the best interest of the town.
Maybe if you were working 5 days a week, it'd be easier.
And you don't live in town either, so.
If you're working 5 days a week instead of four, you're easier to spread it out and you feel so overwhelmed. Who answers the phone all the time? 6,000 calls? Wow. I'm guessing that's 150 a day?
Well, it's calls for service. It's not telephone. 150
calls a day.
It's not telephone calls.
That's what
show.
So I can explain that. I can get into more detail with that if you'd like. I mean, it's more time consuming. We have a record management system that anytime we do something in law enforcement, anytime we provide a service to the community or we do something, we put it into the system. That's a call for service. So those are the calls for service. The number of telephone calls that we get, and I have statistical data. You know, last year we had 187 911 calls. We had 500 of, we included in the town report the 500 plus calls that are more of a serious nature. But then on top of that, you had motor vehicle stops. Every motor vehicle stop gets put in as a call for service. So don't look at it as a telephone call. Look at it as an activity. Maybe that's a better word for it. A police activity, a police-initiated activity, that's what we're looking at. So the 6,000 calls, there's a list of 50 different things that we put in that we do, house checks, building checks, administrative duties, meetings, all of these different things that we do as our police duties, that stuff goes in as calls.
Yeah.
So let me see if I understand the first option, full-time officer, that third officer would work, what, Fridays? But when would his first day be? Friday, Saturday, and Sunday? He'd work. What are the days that would work? You've got you and the...
For the full-time officer?
Yes, you've got the chief and...
I have it as working Sunday. Tuesday through Saturday, so that takes out Tuesday two part-time shifts per week. That's the 19...
So we're always taking out is the Saturday shifts.
Friday afternoon and
Friday Saturday. And Saturday.
Friday and Saturday.
Shift Saturday.
Right now, Friday afternoon.
If you looked at why that officer can't work Thursday through Monday... And replace, and that would replace the part-timers on one of the part-times on the weekends.
You can look at the schedule, and I did it. I mean, you can look at the schedule and schedule it out 50 different ways.
You got three officers there for three officers for 3 days of the week, and on a weekend, one day of the weekend he's there, but the other day is part-timers. I mean, what are the three going to do in the office at the same time? And you only have what, two vehicles, I guess, right? Or is it three vehicles? There's three vehicles. Okay, and the three can go out at the same time, I guess, but. Yeah. I just think convincing the public here that you need three police officers in the town of Whately during a weekday when you got backup from mutual aid from surrounding towns, yeah, it takes time to get there. Fine.
You don't want to be the one waiting for that time, though.
We can't have everything instant. You got state police around the corner, state police in town even.
Won't you feel safer?
Pardon?
Won't you feel safer?
No.
So ultimately, this looks like a waste of time. Then, I mean, you've got
preconceived. It's a hard sell in a small town.
Yeah, it's not even a sell. You guys already have it determined.
We're getting feedback from residents saying, "Why do you need three?" I mean,
I'm getting feedback from a lot of residents. Asking why we don't have more coverage? Why we're not out there
they
more?
Should be sitting over there. Well,
you want to have them in here?
The bottom line in this whole thing is, if the select board feels that for the safety of this town, that position needs to be filled, then they need to communicate that to us, and we'll have that discussion at that time. I think we know where you sit, obviously, and I think you got the best interest of the town at heart, I really do. The only thing I struggle with is, I don't want a uniformed officer sitting on his butt in an office pushing paper. To me, I want you in a car, on the street, but that's not my call. But as a taxpayer, that's what I want.
Yeah.
And I see no reason why just a someone from the community, an administrator, a clerk, could not do the bulk.
And they can do administrative tasks, yes. I agree with that.
But if
I'm out of town for a meeting, or if I'm doing something else tied up with something, and we have an administrator sitting in the office, and the call goes out where you need service, they can't provide a service to anybody.
You know, when you're out of town, you tell me he's not in charge?
Well, no, nobody's on. There isn't money in the budget to put somebody on every time I'm out of town.
He wouldn't be in charge of the police, the clerk.
No.
Well, that's what
I'm saying Don.
That's what he said. You just thought you said that.
No. I don't mean the clerk.
Well, you mean
when you're out of town, doing whatever you have to do.
Yep.
And in the police presence in town, are you saying there's no police presence in town when you leave?
Correct.
Well, there isn't 24-hour anyway. There's only 16-hour, whatever, the two shifts, and they overlap. So what do you have from 7 in the morning till 11 at night, midnight?
Yeah.
So you're, yep. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, and people have asked me to, I mean, you guys chuckle, you talk about the hours, the four 10-hour days. People have asked me to come in later, and we do office hours, stay later to do office hours. I mean, people, I talked with the select board about that years and years ago, and that was the best option that came up.
I guess I would still like to see the effect on your budget of the third officer working, say, Thursday for the 4 or 5 days, starting on Thursday, so you don't have three officers there. What does that impact? How does that impact your budget?
What do you mean having three officers?
Well, instead of three officers there on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, that person would start either Thursday or Friday. So you have some overlap.
You wouldn't have three people.
If you want coordination among all three, pick one day, and then that officer would work the 4 days after that. I'd like to see how that impacts your budget. You don't show that here, that I could see.
I'm not sure I'm following.
He doesn't understand.
I'm not sure I'm following.
He thinks that the He thinks the two officers are on 8 hours a day, and you're trying to get a third one in.
No.
That's what he's saying.
Same 8 hours a day.
No.
Well, it would be the same shift.
No.
That's not in the best interest of the community.
Well, I think to make things a little simpler, to sell it a little better, okay? Total number of shifts. Total hours.
It's there.
You know, total people you have who work in those shifts.
It's there, yeah.
You know, in a pie chart. You know?
I hear you.
I'm not kidding you.
No, I hear you.
Graphics.
But I've spent,
you know,
probably 20 hours doing all of the administrative stuff for the budget and for this and all that stuff.
Yep.
So to go back and spend more time doing pie graphs and charts. I'm not saying I'm not going to do it. If you want it, I'll do it. I'm just trying to present what I can as simple as I can.
Push comes to shove on town floor, Officer Sabine, could you please come up and show the town why you need? You don't want this.
Yeah.
That's.
Uh-uh.
No.
Yeah.
You want something that's graphic and shows.
Oh, yeah.
People go, oh, okay, now I get it.
Yeah. I hear you.
That's what you want.
Yeah, I didn't think I needed that at this level
for an intimate
environment.
You know, but
that's why I didn't do a PowerPoint.
As it gets closer to 8:30, I wish I had it.
That's right.
A bunch of stuff. No, I mean, you know, like we said before, it's the selectman's call, and
that's,
I know you're passionate
about
it. That's
why there's
options there.
That's
a good thing.
Yeah.
You know, so.
I've got one question.
Sure.
The calls for service. The volume of calls for service. Whately has about 1,700 more per year than the nearest next town, which is Ashfield.
Do you guys have the?
Yes,
we 5,869 calls per year versus 4,100. That's the next.
The next highest call volume. Yeah.
Call volume.
Yeah.
Why are there so many calls, more calls in Whately than any other town?
So there's when you enter a call for service. And I have the list. If you guys, I mean, you don't want to look at all those numbers and all that stuff, but you want to see charts. But on that list, there's 152 call reasons that you can put in for. So if I do a building check, I put in a building check as my call reason. So a lot of towns, they'll put in, if I'm driving down Chestnut Plain Road, they'll put that in as a call because I'm patrolling that road. And then when they go over to Haydenville Road, they'll put in a call because they're patrolling that road. So looking at the numbers that I can see, and I don't want to accuse any town of inflating anything or doing anything like that, and the numbers are there. If you guys want them, you can have them. So you can see exactly what we're doing, the number of calls. But there are those types of things where, you know, some departments put in absolutely everything. If they go back to the station, they put it in as an administrative call. Or anytime they're patrolling a road, they put it in as an administrative call. So some of those numbers, I mean, they're the numbers that we have. Are they the best judge of it? Probably not. But those are the numbers. So
you're not making stops. You're not taking extra time to make these calls. I mean, you're driving by and you're just logging in that you've driven by this business. So
for us, a business check means you're pulling in, either getting out of the car, walking around and checking it. Or if it's a facility like Berkshire Gas, for example, we pull up to the gate, we check to make sure there's no tampering with the gate or the buttons or anything like that. If there's somebody inside, then we continue on. But we do house checks. People go on vacation, we check their house, we walk around, check the windows, check the house, we do home assessments, we do security assessments, things like that. We do a lot of those things, and those get entered in as building checks, or that may get put in as an assist citizen call or something like that. But every time I roll down the window and wave to somebody, I don't say that's a community policing activity and I create a call for that. We don't do that, and officers on our department, and you can look at the numbers, we don't do that.
And what's the difference between hours covered per week and hours paid per week?
So the hours covered per week would be me starting at 7 in the morning and Don working till 11 o'clock at night, so that would be the total number of hours for that day, but we overlap in the afternoon, so we have to reduce those hours because it's an overlap. We have two people at the same time, so we're not doubling the coverage. We're just saying that these number of hours are covered from 7 in the morning to 11 at night. There is a couple hours overlap each day. that we have. So that's why there's a difference in the numbers. And if you add the full-time officer and you get two on during the day, there's going to be that overlap. So we don't count that additional 40 hours as other hours, more hours covered. We count it as more hours paid. You're paying for it. You're not necessarily covering more hours in a day. There's only 24 hours in a day, so.
Last time we checked that.
Is there somebody interested in this position, or do you know?
We currently have one, possibly two people. You're talking a full-time position?
Yeah, full-time.
We don't have anybody full-time qualified right now that's come to me and said, we have two people in the police academy. We have one that's works at a college campus. He's got full-time academy trained. Maybe he would come over, so we could possibly put somebody on, so maybe one person that we could pull from in-house. Anybody else in-house, we'd have to send them to the academy or go outside of the department and bring somebody in. Ideally, it would be nice to bring somebody from the department that's already familiar with the community, then it's less training that we have to do.
Are all your part-timers residents of Whately?
No.
No. So would that be a requirement for this one?
No.
Okay, well, I think at the end of the day, if you can make the argument why it was safer.
Ideally, if you could work cooperatively with another town to share a position, it probably would work better because they're sharing the benefits, because the benefits drive the cost of the position way up here.
Yeah, that's been discussed a number of times with a number of towns across the state. It never works out fiscally. It hasn't worked.
We're in a small enough area where it might work.
Yeah, you're looking at a small enough area geographically with 1,600 people in it, but we also have free state highways.
You got to get the right person.
We have a lot of traffic coming through town. So that's, if you take us, you take our size town and you put it somewhere off the beaten path, we're not going to have the call volume that we have. We have the call volume that we have because of our location with the traffic, 15, 20,000 cars a day coming through off of
the marijuana place at the Miles.
Yeah, or the one that's still pending up at Sugarloaf Shop. You know, we've got dispensaries that want to come in. We've got manufacturing that wants to come in. So those are the growth things that I put in the proposal.
We get you. Thanks for going back.
Not a problem.
We appreciate your effort. Any other? Can we wrap this? Is this?
Please. Any other questions? Topic before this meeting.
No, I want to ask one more question.
First topic.
I want to ask one more question of Fred of why the DeMiles property hasn't been marketed yet. So that's the question I get.
No, we don't. That's we're not getting that. We're not
I
going.
I just want to ask that. Put that out there for the
that's not a police question.
Call Dan Dennehy. He'll tell you.
We still need in a heart of this special town meeting warrant.
We'll make it quick.
Okay, we're going to do special town meeting warrant.
I can go as quick as you want.
Okay.
All right, go.
You're done.
Article 1, do you recommend it?
Yes.
Hold on. Stop.
I'll summarize them.
Go ahead.
No, we got to read them.
Wait, I don't see it.
Well, right here. Come on, stay here with the program. Okay, here we go. I'll read it.
I got you.
Article 1, just listen. See if the town vote to accept General Law Chapter 200A, 9A, authorizing the town to dispose of abandoned funds held in the custody of the town per the procedure outlined by the statute, or take any other action relative thereto. Could you please?
Sure, that allows us to keep the money.
Yeah.
From what?
Unclaimed checks. Okay. Unclaimed checks, right, we have to send them to the state and it goes in the abandoned property division. This is a local acceptance law that would allow us to publish notice that we have unclaimed funds.
What's
the
time frame?
We have to wait a year.
Okay.
And how much are we talking?
Any unclaimed funds. So if I was to write a check for, I don't know, Eversource, and they never claimed the check, and they never cashed it, then we could publish notice that says, Eversource, you have a check for $100 from the town of Whately, you need to claim it within X amount of time. If you don't, then the debt is considered paid in full, and the town
cashes
the money.
Have we done this before?
No, it's a local opt-in.
That's the problem. So it won't be a problem anymore. Do I have a motion?
I make a motion, we accept it.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Done.
I make the motion, the select board also recommend.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Boom, boom.
Article two.
Go.
See if the town will vote to accept the last paragraph of General Law 141-11, blah, blah, blah. Create a special fund to be known as the Injury Leave Indemnity Fund to be expended by the select board without further appropriation for payment of injury leave compensation or medical bills incurred under General Law Chapter 41, 111F or 102, which appropriations may be made and amounts received for insurance proceeds or restitution for injuries to firefighters or police officers shall be credited, provided that said board may, if the amounts therein are not immediately necessary or required for the foreseeable future of the purpose of the fund, release specific amounts to the general fund.
Right, so this allows us to avoid what we're doing in Article 3. This allows us to create a special revenue fund where if somebody goes out, if an officer or firefighter goes out on injured on duty, we can accept the reimbursement proceeds into this account and pay out of that account right now. Yeah. Any reimbursements we get go to the general fund.
Okay.
And it requires a town meeting appropriation to get them back out into the budget where that salary was paid, which is why Article 3 exists.
Okay. So we have a motion on Article 2.
And make a motion we accept Article 2.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Select board?
I make a motion that we recommend this article.
Article 2, second.
Aye.
Favor, aye.
Done.
Article 3 is, for that reason, it's $9,000 paid out of the budget to cover the leave time.
So can we just assume that both are approved?
Yep.
Passed? Okay, Article 3 is done. 2 and 3.
So my recommendation, this is the recommendation of the select board that we remove Article 4.
I would agree with that.
Absolutely.
Okay.
My reasoning is probably different than...
No, I can't tell you what my reasoning would be.
Then yours.
Turn the camera off.
Yeah.
Well, you can't.
But I'm not sure it's necessary, and even if it were necessary, I think the select board should consider a written policy to that effect before we make that appropriation.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
Okay.
So what do you need
The select board controls the contents of the warrant, so if you want to not include Article 4, that's...
Yeah. I think we should not include Article 4.
Okay, I agree with you.
Okay, Article 5.
To see if the town will vote pursuant to General Law 44B to appropriate and transfer from the Community Preservation Unreserved Fund balance a sum of $28,130.92 to make an additional payment on the 1-year note for the Town Hall Historic Rehabilitation Project or take any other action relative thereto.
So this is an additional payment on top of the $43,000 that's appropriated at the last annual town meeting to pay down the debt for the town hall. This will leave $200,000 left.
So this is accelerating the debt, accelerating the payment?
The pay.
Okay.
Yep. Any questions? Do we have a motion?
I make a motion to accept Article 5.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Done.
Okay.
I move
that the board also recommend Article 5.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. All right. Jim, Article 6.
To see if the town will vote to transfer the sum of $50,000 from the Capital Stabilization Fund to pay for costs associated with the replacement of two bridges on Williamsburg Road or take any other action relative thereto.
So we have the Williamsburg Road Bridge project and we received bids. And the base bid, the low bid, was $567,000 and some change. The alternate one was $84,000 and some change for a total project cost of $651,896. We have a small bridge grant of $497,000. $116,000 of that is buried in design and construction oversight, which leaves us a deficit, a difference just from the base bid of $186,437. Keith's been saving Chapter 90 monies for, you know, because we thought there would be a shortfall. There's about $155,000 left, and we're expecting to get another $144,000 available July 1st. What we're running into and why this is necessary is that in order to award the contract, we need to show on paper that we have all of the available funds. The intent here is that we would appropriate the money to show that we have it on paper, And then when the additional Chapter 90 money comes in that we can spend July 1st, this money would be moved back to the stabilization account.
So to wash.
When will this happen?
If this passes, we can sign the contract in April. There's a 10 to 12 week lead time on ordering the bridge components. So we're talking August, September.
Okay.
So if we get additional town money from other grants, I know from other
right.
grants, then this $50,000 may not be necessary.
This is the idea. Short term loan.
It's a wash.
Yeah. Right. The idea is we would never
go
use this.
Going back.
We're also making a request and yeah. working with MassDOT to provide us additional funds through the small bridge program to make up the difference.
Yeah.
But they haven't guaranteed. There's no guarantee that they're going to give us that money.
Okay. Any other further comments, questions? Do we get a motion?
I make a motion to accept Article 6.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Move the select board recommend Article 6 too.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Take us home, Dan.
Okay, see if the town will vote to transfer the sum of $4,000 from available funds for Spring FY19 free cash to pay for the cost of engineering oversight services during the construction of crosswalks, sidewalks along Chester Plain Road, or take any other action relative thereto.
So we have the $200,000 complete streets grant that's going to pay for the construction of the sidewalks and the crosswalks. That project will hopefully go out to bid in the next month. We've put in $4,000 already for engineering. We were able to use Sarah Campbell, who's a semi-retired city engineer, instead of using somebody that has some certifications from MassDOT, which would have really more than quadrupled the cost. So she's also willing to do the construction oversight, so we save a pretty good chunk of money. And the total town money on this project would be around $8,000. At the end of the day, it's not too bad.
No, it's four. Okay, additional four. Any questions, thoughts, motion?
I make a motion we accept Article 7.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Bingo.
The select board also recommend Article 7.
Second.
Aye.
Aye. Move to
adjourn.
Second.
I can also answer any questions on the other budgets if anybody has any questions.
Is this meeting going to be held here?
Yeah.
Okay.
It doesn't have to be tonight. You can.
When's the next meeting?
The next meeting 24th, is
right?
The 24th. We'll have to move the general government over to that meeting.
Yep.
Okay. So we didn't quite get to that due to time constraints.
Yep. We got part of it.
And lack of it. That was good. Yeah. Absolutely. But that's out front.
He writes his own grants.
Yeah.
Any other business in the last 48 hours, we'll defer to the next meeting.
Okay. How about the revolving fund that you don't agree with?